No.
Don't you want to marry me?
I'm going to marry Melanie.
But you can't, not if you care for me.
Oh, my dear wife.
Oh, yeah.
He's cut! Russian's cut, and it's a bad cut! And now...
You complete... I'm up just now.
Shut up. You had me at hello.
Movies, man.
Hey, film friends. I'm Nick Furman. This is Furman on Film. Welcome to the channel. In today's video, we'll be reviewing Babylon. But before that, we'd just like to let you know about our newest blog post, the top 20 films of 2022. Now, we'll leave a link in the description, so please do us a favor and check it out. If you're new to the channel, our format is simple. We'll start off with a quick synopsis, then discuss some of my own likes and dislikes, before concluding with a bit of deeper analysis on the themes and some of my own original thoughts on the film. For those of you who know the deal and have been here before, feel free to skip around and use the timestamps in the description below. And of course, as always, please stay to the end to get our FOF rating out of 5 stars. Without further ado, this is Babylon. Babylon chronicles the rise and fall of multiple characters during Hollywood's transition from silent to sound films in the late 1920s. It is a tale of outsized ambition and outrageous excess during an era of unbridled decadence and depravity in early Hollywood. This is a 3-hour-plus juggernaut. It not only depicts the experience of being coked out on screen, but also seems to simulate the very experience of partaking in it. So we've heard. This comes to us in the form of an overstuffed narrative with frenetic pacing and cutting, expansive sequences with dozens of extras, and whirling camera dervishes at every turn. Well, let's start with what I liked about Babylon. Well, from the opening scene to the snake sequence in the desert, about the 90-minute mark, this film is incredible. It's operating at a fever pitch I've rarely seen before. It's some of the most impressive filmmaking you'll see. The first scene is an epic 28-minute party, which features drugs, sex, a full jazz band, more abs than you can count, wild dancing, and other debauchery, and an elephant stomping through a great hall. Not to mention more impressive camera shots and tracking movements than most films contain in their entire runtime. It's Chazelle pulling out all the stops, dropping the gauntlet, and saying to us, "This is the film you've come to see." The next scene moves into a long and explosive sequence of filming multiple silent films on a giant outdoor lot. Spike Jones as the wild-eyed German film director and Margot Robbie's coming out party dancing on the bar might just be the pinnacle of this whole shebang. The whole encounter is madly kinetic and hilarious in multiple places. As the years move on and Hollywood transitions to the beginning of sound pictures, we get our next great scene. This is the first sound scene in a studio. Now the littlest noises from the outside, marks on the floor, and microphone placement become infinitely more important. PJ Byrne is on fire in this scene. Honestly, everything about the act and art of making movies here is simply stunning. You know, when he tries to out Fellini. The score is terrific as well. Much has been made of its connection to one of Chazelle's other films, La La Land. And composer Justin Hurwitz has owned this, claiming, "I'm the same composer and my musical grammar is the same." I'd also like to point out that the final film moment, which I will not spoil, is great. It's very effective at capturing this essence of movie magic. Performance-wise, Margot Robbie is very good, as usual, and Calva plays the everyman well, if a little dully. He's simply the avatar for the audience. But I was probably more impressed with Byrne and Olivia Hamilton and some of the other side bit parts. And Giovanna Depo was terrific as the trumpet player as well. Finally, I just want to meet head-on one of the main criticisms I've read of this movie. The complaint of excess or that the picture is just too long just never really registered with me. In fact, it's actually the point that Chazelle is making. Sure, maybe he gets a little high on his own supply sometimes, sometimes. But what better way to send up an era of hubris than to indulge in some of your own licentious excess as well? Okay, so let's move on to some of my dislikes of the picture. Well, I can honestly say that I dug the Tobey Maguire descent into the bowels of a Dantean hell scene too. But I liked that kind of thing a little more when it was Alfred Molina in Boogie Nights. We'll come back to that film again. Another issue I found is what we're to do with the incredibly truncated story of the black trumpet player and the Asian girl. It's a huge ensemble cast, but certain characters just get short shrift. And it's made worse by the fact that both of these characters' stories are two of the more engaging ones of the entire film. Now, some have said that this was an intentional move by Chazelle because these characters would have been marginalized at that time in Hollywood. But I don't really buy that. But I've also heard that there was a 4-hour version of this script initially. I think it's much more likely that they just truncated those two smaller parts in the final cut. But my bigger criticism lies with the third or so hour of this picture, what Elric calls a meandering death dream. In this hour, Chazelle tries to move into a wistful meditation on the fleeting nature of fame and the way that the Hollywood machine can swallow you up and spit you out. It's about the precarious place that those who fail to meet this town's rigorous demands find themselves. You know, many have discussed all the big swings this film takes, but the three leads' narrative arcs are just rather archetypal to me. The struggle for an aging Hollywood star, or the rough ride for a new ingenue. And honestly, the two films it reminded me the most of are simply better than it. Boogie Nights, Wolf of Wall Street, a little of Goodfellas in there too. It's as if the film gets the parties and the excess so well, it specializes in the world building. But when it settles down to make its grander point, to tear it all down, I have to ask, are the endings of the Robbie and Calva tales really satisfying? Do people love this film because it's so audacious, or because it's narratively gratifying? Now, I could point to some individual scenes, like the extremely broad comedy of manners sequence with Robbie, or others like it. They just add nothing new to the picture, and what's worse, they slow the momentum from the first half. If anything, they recall better scenes in other stories. And because of some of these things, the ending, which I freely acknowledge was very powerful, connected more with my head than my heart. All right, let's get to any remaining thoughts or themes that we still need to consider. You know, Babylon is a fun reflection piece in several regards. Was there a more divisive film critically this year than this picture? One more prone to evoke effusive praise from so many and moralizing boos or claims of senseless, overwrought excess by others? You know, I think that Babylon is asking you to consider a paradox. It is the paradox of transcendent beauty, art, and escape being birthed from and built upon a venal world of literal excrement, piss, and vomit, and the dangers of irrelevancy threatening to encroach on fame and influence at every turn. See, my head gets that profoundly. It's awesome stuff. But when you've narratively walked us through five characters, two of which are almost footnotes, and the other three of which are either unoriginal or only really engaging when in the throes of bacchanalia, how am I supposed to make that heart connection? How am I supposed to scream movies with tears running down my face in those final moments? Like Damien would want us all to do. I love movies, yeah, but I connected with the character's wildness more than any grand and emotive conclusion. So what can we conclude? You know, critics have called Chazelle's work everything from sloppy, arrogant, and self-indulgent, bordering on the masturbatory. Hey, the critics said it, not me. To overstuffed and totally bonkers. But they've also noted that it is irritatingly beautiful, consistently mesmerizing, that you simply cannot get it out of your head once it's there. It showcases punctilious craftsmanship in every below-the-line category. Cinematography, editing, production, and costume design. It boasts sure-footed performances and a grippingly kinetic jazz score. So say what you will about the final product, just the fact that he pulled something off that was big enough and punchy enough to challenge Marty and PTA may just speak to what a big swing this really was. And the way that Babylon drives home the theme of transformative movie magic being built on the back of a cadre of lecherous characters, well, that's about as fitting an homage to old Hollywood as you'll ever find. Well, there you have it. The only thing left to discuss is our rating for this film. FOF gives Babylon 3.9 out of 5 stars. Wow, you couldn't round that to a 4? Sorry, Scott. It's just not a 4-star film. If you enjoyed this review, please let us know by smashing that like button and subscribing to the channel. You can also hit that little bell so you get notified every time we release a new video. We would love to hear your comments. Do you agree with our rating? What was your score for Babylon? Also, please don't forget to head on over to furmanonfilm.com where you can get your fix on lots of movie reviews, deep dives, and so much more content. Thanks for watching. I'm Nick Furman. This is Furman on Film. Stay firm, my friends.